The city of Budapest, the capital of Hungary, and one of the most beautiful cities in Europe. Clustered around the great river Danube, which slices the city in two, Budapest was originally two separate towns. On the eastern bank, the downtown districts of Pest. On the hilly west bank lies Buda. The Gellert Hill, with the Freedom Monument and Citadel at its peak, is the oldest inhabited part of Budapest. Heroes Square is another of Budapest's many monuments. It has been said that if one is traveling from Western Europe, it is in Budapest that one first experiences the flavor of Eastern Europe. However, if one is traveling in the opposite direction, coming from the east, it is in Budapest that one first experiences the decadence and freedom of Western Europe. With its lively, bustling streets and pavement cafes, one could almost be in Paris or Rome or any modern European city. From Budapest's Western Railway Station, there is a daily train service to and from the Czech Republic. And it was here that we met a rather special train arriving in from the capital city of Prague. Drawn by a sleek black steam locomotive, this highly polished train with gleaming brasswork and shining green livery glides onto the station platform. Hundreds of people had gathered to witness the pageant, for the locomotive was about to be officially named Budapest, and this was to mark the inaugural run of the world's most secret train, the Imperial Express. As the locomotive with its shining new nameplate sat on the station platform, the guests were invited into the grand and palatial royal waiting room.
On the Imperial Express, we're about changing a trend in railways. Railways are becoming faster, more streamlined, more sterile and more clinical. We're actually about putting a bit of style and a bit of fun back into it. We're about celebrating railways. We're about using steam engines. We're about classic values. We're about dining on trains. And we're about eating on trains. We're also about using the train to explore bits of the countryside that ordinary travellers, people like me who are not good at languages, who don't like hassle with currency and strange hotels, go and see areas that we wouldn't normally see. An area that is of incredible natural beauty, villages, towns and cities. And I think the train actually totally fits that package. It provides a very comfortable environment to set off on an adventure in. We've kept the very best of world railway practice, onboard service and catering. The train itself was a state secret for 40 years. It really was a case of turn to the wall as the gentlemen ride by. Now it's available for people to travel in and to enjoy. The train was built for the Hungarian president, although of course with Hungary's history at that time it was closer to a dictator than a president. And he simply instructed the railways to build him a luxury train, which is what they did. And when the country became communist in 1948, the train dates from the 1930s, when it turned to communism, communism was about equality for all people, but there was a special type of equality for the apparatchiks who actually ran the Communist Party. And they used this train. They hijacked it for their own use, and they ran around within Hungary and to other communist countries for government meetings and things. They knew how to live, and they knew how to live well. We found it by kicking a lot of doors down. We have enjoyed railway careers within British Rail, and you have access to international computers that indicate to you that there are funny numbers that don't belong to any carriages. So you go off and play Sherlock Holmes, and eventually you find either something interesting or something quite terrible. We found a lot of terrible ones before we found this.
The Imperial Railway Company now operate the train on a regular schedule throughout the year between Budapest and Prague, and also on occasions to and from Vienna. It was at a railway siding in Prague that we met the train and its crew for the first time, as they were preparing the vehicle for its next journey to Budapest. Having just come from the wash, each carriage was being thoroughly cleaned and polished prior to picking up the next group of passengers waiting for the train at a railway station in the nearby city centre of Prague. Although there did not appear to be any rush or panic as the staff went about their business, it was evident that something was not quite as it should be.
Well, we've lost our 1920s Pullman bar car, which is a stupid thing to mislay, but unfortunately it's got a technical problem, and so it's literally died on us in Vienna. And our Austrian friends have lent us this, which, as you can see, is just a little bit Spartan. So we're now running around with 3 hours to go, trying to convert this into a garden bar as a replacement for the Art Deco piano bar. I think we'll do it, but already I've lost all my fingernails.
Undeterred by the loss of a carriage, the show goes on as the crew prepare this replacement. Most of the crew on the Imperial Express are Hungarian. However, the catering crew are all British, and the language of the train is English. This is the train's head steward, and this trip will be his first time on this train, although he's worked on similar trains in England. It appears that old habits die hard. He told us that the Hungarian staff will still not enter a cabin if the occupant's suitcases have been left open, for fear of casting an accidental eye over secret documents, a once potentially fatal offence. With only an hour to go, the train still seemed far from ready.
I know, that'll be fine, we'll survive. it'll be okay on the night.
The train is now being shunted to another siding for last-minute checks and final preparations. The distance from Prague to Budapest is over 600 miles, which by regular express train would take about 7 hours. However, on the Imperial Express, the journey, or land cruise, as the operators like to call it, will take us 52 hours. Sleeping accommodation on the train is in two classes. There are presidential class cabins, each with a full-size double bed, spacious lounge area, and private shower and bathroom facilities. During the day, the cabins are converted into comfortable private day lounges. There are also first-class two-berth cabins, which are converted each night into accommodation with two single bunk beds. Although there are no private bathrooms in these cabins, each is fitted with individual wash basins with hot and cold water. Ever since the fall of communism, the Imperial Express carriages have been hidden away in a Hungarian railway shed. Except for a few special charters, the train has remained relatively untouched since being used by the Hungarian president. On those charters, as with ours, the train still retains all the privileges of a presidential train, meaning that it has priority on all routes, and in the event of a breakdown, the driver can commandeer any passing locomotive. It is Eastern Europe's equivalent of a royal train. Whilst being used to ferry the president and top government officials, the train was operated by Hungary's secret police and was cared for by hand-picked craftsmen, some of whom are still with the train today. It's almost time to leave, and we are now being hooked up to an ancient diesel locomotive, which appears to have been designed by the same team responsible for designing the Trabant. This locomotive will take us from the siding into Prague, where we shall meet up with the first of the steam locomotives that will pull us during the day on our journey through Bohemia and the Czech Republic, Slovakia and Hungary, ending finally 2 days later in Budapest. In fact, after 150 years of railway travel, the Imperial Express is Europe's last scheduled international steam haul train. However, by night, the Imperial Express changes over from steam-driven to more modern-powered locomotives, which are less noisy and less intrusive whilst passengers are trying to sleep. Our journey will start at Prague Central Station, and it was here that we would pick up the 40 or so passengers who would be joining the train. Neil Howard from the Imperial Railway Company was at the station, greeting and checking in the passengers as they arrived. Whilst waiting for the train, They were treated to champagne and canapés in the magnificent and ornate presidential waiting room at Prague Station. This room had remained shut away from public gaze for over 40 years. It is perhaps worth considering that had the general populace clapped eyes on this sort of capitalist decadence, they might not have waited until 1989 to boot out its supposedly egalitarian masters. The Imperial Express was now underway en route to Prague. Everything was prepared and ready. The staff had changed from their working clothes into white and crisply laundered crew uniforms. And despite one or two last-minute hitches, the head steward was eagerly waiting to start his first trip.
Everything's ready. We're picking a couple more waitresses up, stewards later on, in Prague. I'm ready and raring to go, to be absolutely honest. Should be a really good 3 days, good trip.
The train was approaching Prague's main station, a drab, cathedral-like structure completed in 1979. Which was obviously, by communist standards, once a magnificent-looking building. Until recently, these railways used by the Imperial Express lay deep behind the Iron Curtain and were shrouded in secrecy and mystery. The cities of Prague and Budapest may have been known by some international travelers, but most definitely not known was what lay between them. Three more staff have arrived from England and are quickly shown to their cabins and given their instructions. The passengers have begun boarding, and there is an air of excitement as they see the train for the first time. Some passengers were having their photographs taken with the gleaming green carriages as a backdrop. But up ahead at the front of the train was an even greater photo opportunity as the first of the grand old steam locomotives, which were going to pull the train on its journey to Budapest, coupled up with the train. Owned by the Czech Railways, this is one of 15 Skoda locomotives in her class, and was one of the last to be built in 1954 in the then Czechoslovakia. In distinctive dark blue livery, this magnificent blue albatross locomotive used to pull the big express trains during the steam age, and now, no longer bedecked with the red star of communism, will pull the Imperial Express as far as Brno, where the train will arrive late in the evening. The final whistle of departure is blown by the platform guard, and the locomotive lets out its response, the sound echoing around the cavernous station. Whether you're a fan of trains or not, it's impossible not to feel the air of nostalgia and excitement as you listen to the endearing sound and power of the steam locomotive gradually picking up speed. Ahead of us, two parallel lines of steel determining our route to a new adventure. We slowly make our way, winding through the city of Prague, climbing steeply as we go. The locomotive at this point is aided by the same diesel locomotive which brought the train from the sidings, which is now connected to the rear and is pushing us, whilst the gentle steam giant up at the front is pulling. The Imperial Express, with 10 carriages, is over 300 meters long and weighs more than 450 tons. Later in the afternoon, we approach the town of Havlíčkův Brod. As the passengers alighted, they were greeted by the train staff with Hungarian champagne. It was a most peculiar sight for the local townsfolk, who gazed in amazement at the scene of unrivaled luxury as the passengers, some of whom were dressed in all their finery, promenaded along the platform. Guests are encouraged on the Imperial Express, as with most of the world's great luxury trains, to dress formally for dinner. One couldn't help but imagine that possibly the last time the townsfolk saw this train, it could have been carrying a bunch of hard-faced apparatchiks, perhaps also dressed in a similar style, enjoying their fine brandy and cigars, and indulging in the luxury of a special style of communism only reserved for the chosen few. However, this type of decadence would never have been displayed in public, and the train would have passed quickly through the station without stopping, whilst their subjects toiled long and hard in the surrounding fields. For most of the passengers, politics could not have been further from their minds. More interesting for some was a chance to view the locomotive close up and get up on the footplate. Nothing could look more incongruous than a man dressed in a dinner suit amongst the soot and grease of a steam locomotive. Shortly before sunset, the train is ready to leave. The driver sounds the final whistle, and the locals watch as the locomotive throws out a cloud of black smoke. Slowly edging away from the station platform, its mighty wheels rumbling as it slowly gathers speed, the magnificent blue albatross continues on its journey into the past. And for the passengers, another episode is about to unfurl in this living recreation of the golden age of rail. We are continuing westward to the town of Brno in the Czech Republic. It is here that we stop and change locomotives, during which time the guests are given the chance to enjoy their first meal aboard the train. Dining on board is a celebration of Hungarian cuisine, which until very recently was relatively unknown. In the traditional vintage railway setting of white tablecloths, romantic lighting and inlaid marquetry, the guests sit down for dinner in the wagon-lit dining car. The meal is accompanied by an endless supply of complimentary Hungarian wines and legendary Czech beers. Unlike some of the world-class trains, there is only one sitting for dinner on the Imperial Express, so passengers whom by now are all getting to know one another are welcome and even encouraged by the ever-attentive staff to linger at the table with coffee and liqueurs to continue the conversation well into the night. It is early morning, and we've been traveling through the night. We've arrived at the border crossing with Slovakia, and customs are taking their time in completing the necessary formalities with the passengers' passports. On board, while most of the passengers are asleep, the cabin stewards are up and already working. Each carriage has its own original wood-fired boiler for hot water, which is lit every morning. Meanwhile, at the front of the train, there's been a new addition. We've now been joined by the second of the steam locomotives. For the aficionados, this is a class 475, which was built just after the war and operated by the Czechoslovakian National Railways. For the non-enthusiasts, it was still a magnificent sight in the early morning light. This locomotive is now preserved and operated by the Slovakian State Railways. and will take us, once we've cleared the customs here at Cornelia Deck, as far as Hilda's Nemetti. Fortunately for the rest of the passengers who were asleep and unaware of the delay, it was in fact the camera equipment on board which was causing concern for the customs officers, who, unlike air or seaport officials, were unused to filling out complicated paperwork at the sleepy railway border crossing. Now, having been at the border for almost 2 hours, whilst the head customs officer had been fetched out of bed to complete the formalities, the passengers on board were beginning to arrive at the dining car for breakfast.
Now, for breakfast, you have a choice of either Weetabix or cornflakes or muesli, and then followed by scrambled egg with smoked salmon, or we have a continental-style breakfast, whichever you would prefer.
As breakfast was served to the passengers who had been unaware of any delay, the train was finally cleared to pull out of the station and continue on to Hungary.
Obviously, it's such a far cry from what we experienced in Australia, but it's magnificent. I think a couple of reasons. One is that we've had a close affinity with steam trains in Australia. They are well restored and provide great entertainment, but they don't provide an opportunity to go away on a trip such as this, the duration of 3 days. And of course, Australia being a relatively young country, it's just a wonderful opportunity to come over and to go right through the heart of Europe, which is so steeped in tradition and the old ways. It is absolutely genuine. There is no air conditioning, you enjoy the soot, but that's absolutely the charm. That's, I think, what makes it so special.
In total, there are 14 staff on the Imperial Express, made up from a mixture of Hungarian and British, the latter mainly working in the restaurant and bar, whilst the Hungarians look after the carriages and manage the train. It is clearly apparent that this train is run by people with a great love of trains, for passengers who enjoy both trains and travel. A short time into the journey, the camera crew on board create another stir, this time with the arrival of the airborne camera mounted in a helicopter. We are now approaching the Tatra mountain range, which can be seen in the distance, and the mountain resort town of Poprad. This town has a history dating back hundreds of years. In fact, it was first mentioned in a document written in 1256. However, it wasn't until 1871, with the arrival of the railway, when it became the most prominent town in this area. Poprad sits at the foot of the mountain range and is often called the entrance gate to the high Tatra Mountains. From Poprad, we disembark the Imperial Express and climb aboard one of the electric trains on the mountain railway network, which will take us on the first leg of our journey up the mountain. Travelling up through the lush green pine forests, which sit like a necklace all around the foot of the High Tatras, towards the alpine heights of the snow-capped peaks, we leave the town of Poprad behind. This area was once known as the Spiss region, which stretched northeast along the Poprad Valley as far as the Polish border and east along the River Hornad towards Presov, and for centuries remained a semi-autonomous province within the Hungarian kingdom. The mountain railway network connects all of the resort towns and spas around the High Tatras, which make up one of Slovakia's most popular tourist destinations, with many hikers visiting the spot in summer, whilst in winter the skiers descend on the area in force. Halfway through our journey up the mountain, we reach the town of Stribska Pleso, and here we change trains. At 1,351 meters above sea level, this town is the highest of all the Tatran mountain towns, with a history as a mountain resort dating back to 1873. This rack railway was built 20 years later in 1893, and this 1913 electric tram, which is going to take us on the rest of our journey up the mountain, will climb 430 meters in just under 5 kilometers. It's now lunchtime, and before continuing any further up the mountain, we transfer once again, this time to a motor coach, which is going to take us to the Grand Hotel at Tatranská Lomnica, possibly the finest and one of the region's few five-star establishments. This magnificent sandy yellow hostelry was built in 1904 in a somewhat vague Alpine neo-Baroque style. With its sprawling green lawns and splendid setting, the Grand Hotel Praha was a sight in its own right and a more than welcome location to adjourn for lunch. This was a very fine affair with traditional Slovakian cuisine and local wines and beer. For those passengers who felt after such a splendid lunch that they just wanted to relax a while or perhaps wander around the local town sightseeing and shopping, There were a few hours to spare before we had to rejoin the train once again. The Imperial Express designs its trips to be as busy or relaxed as the passengers wish. And likewise, the timetable has been scheduled with that in mind. However, for those who wanted to continue the adventure further up the mountain and with a head for heights, there was the cable car ride up to Lomnicky Stick. This, one of the many cable cars in the Tatra Mountains, was originally built by the Germans during World War II, but has been recently completely refurbished. The journey takes about 20 minutes and offers the most spectacular views as you climb through the pine forests towards Sklenet Plesso, which is one of the region's three main ski resorts. Five kilometers northeast of Tatranska Lomnica, where we lunched, is the third highest mountain in the Tatras, Lomnicky Stit, at 2,632 meters. This mountain offers magnificent skiing in winter between the months of December and March, with no less than three black runs for the experts, and has been the site of many international and national winter sports events. The spectacular views were difficult to fault and well worth the effort. The summit of the mountain was still another 500 meters above us, on top of which was an observatory accessible only by a hair-raising single-span cable car, which was doubtlessly not for the faint-hearted. By early evening, as the sun was beginning to set, we were back at Poprad station, and were greeted once again by the customary glass of champagne and the train's own accordion player. The locomotive was ready to leave, and the passengers once again boarded the train to continue their journey towards Budapest. As with our stop on the previous day, we'd become a local attraction, and the people of Poprad were lined along the station platform watching the grand spectacle. Slovaks are a warm and welcoming race, eager to find their place in the new Europe. But one wonders whether life was better or worse for them under communism. After centuries of cultural repression by the Hungarians, followed by 75 years of playing second fiddle to the Czechs within Czechoslovakia, the Slovak Republic finally gained its independence on the 1st of January, 1993. However, since those celebratory days, saddled with an outmoded heavy industrial base forced on them by the communists and slow-moving reforms deterring little outside investment, life has grown much harder for the Slovaks than for the Czechs. For perhaps the first time, having traveled through many of the world's poorer areas, one felt a little embarrassed and even guilty about enjoying such grandeur and decadence. Guilty about the fact that we had the luxury of being able to choose to be extravagant, whether we could afford it or not. But for most of the population in this part of the world under communist rule, being given that choice was never an option. The next part of our journey was to take us through some of the most dramatic scenery in Europe. Spectacular backdrops behind beautiful countryside unveiled itself repeatedly as we steamed eastward, then south towards the border with Hungary. As the sun set for the second time on our adventure, dinner was served. Again, it was a formal affair. But the starchiness and the formalities were relaxed as dinner was cleared and the entertainment began. Everybody on board was now well and truly relaxed and having a good time, enjoying their last night on the train. The sound of conversation amongst the 40 or so guests almost drowned out the live music of the violinist and accordion player. Even the train manager joined in the party mood as the entertainment continued long into the night. An evening that many would remember, particularly next morning. As dawn broke on the third and final day of the journey, we were awoken to find that we had crossed into Hungary and were now about to be joined to our third and final steam locomotive. Pride of the Hungarian Railway's heritage fleet, this is the smallest and oldest of all three. She was built by Floridsdorf in Vienna to fulfill an Austro-Hungarian order, but ended up being delivered in 1915 to the Austrian Southern Railway. And it is that company's distinctive green livery that the engine displays today. In typical Hungarian humor, unlike the stiffer and more serious other two counterparts on this journey of the Czech and Slovak state railways, they have nicknamed this train the Green Frog. In Central European railway history, politics are never far detached, and this locomotive was handed to the Hungarian railways during one of the country's many border changes after the Second World War, and has remained here ever since. Steam locomotives survived a little longer behind the Iron Curtain than in the West, and were still used on freight trains as late as the 1980s. Not for any sentimental reasons, but for financial ones. There was never enough money to buy new diesel or electric engines in the numbers required. Today, this engine, as with the other two, is cared for by professional railway staff, often voluntarily and in their own time. Although of a foreign pedigree, this locomotive is still a favorite of all the Budapest engine crews, who love nothing more than to swap their usual modern cabs for the dirt, noise, and sheer fun of steam. One tradition which apparently has been practiced by steam engine crews almost since the days of Stevenson's rocket is the custom of cooking breakfast on the footplate, using the stoker's shovel as a griddle. In keeping with the age-old habit, the train's director performed the unenviable task of cooking for some of the more enthusiastic of the passengers. Although perhaps even more unenviable was the task of actually eating the finished product. This culinary experience was obviously best left to those with an acquired taste for such delights. It's often said that every schoolboy's dream is to be a steam engine driver. And on the Imperial Express, it is possible to fulfill that childhood fantasy. Everybody is given the opportunity, if they so desire during the trip, to join the crew and ride on the footplate. Even for those with absolutely no interest whatsoever in locomotives, male or female, this is a chance to experience something which should not be missed. Although it is noisy, uncomfortable, and dirty, the sheer exhilaration of riding a steam locomotive is a unique feeling. And one episode in this journey, back in time, yet forwards in space, not to be missed. Our next port of call was the Hungarian cathedral city of Eger. Located in the shelter of the Buck Uplands and among south-facing slopes covered in vineyards famous throughout the world for their bull's blood wine, the city of Eger boasts some of the finest buildings in Hungary. Lying beneath the ramparts of the half-demolished castle which we're just approaching, the little city is brimming with picturesque streets and squares and a skyline punctuated by the towers and spires of several Baroque churches. There are two stations at Eger, and the passengers who want to visit the famous castle are going to be dropped off at the first station, which is built into the remaining castle walls. The ancient city of Eger lies on the hilly uplands in northern Hungary, which separate the Great Plain from the even more mountainous regions of Hungary's neighbor, Slovakia. This medieval fortress withstood the great Turkish onslaught in 1552, halting the Turks and giving Europe a much-needed respite from the Sultan's seemingly unstoppable armies. In 1596, the castle finally fell, and this led to the city becoming the capital of a Turkish province. Eventually, the Turks were driven out of Hungary by the Habsburgs, and subsequently, during the 18th century, Eger became a more typical Central European town, with fine churches, palaces, and townhouses. Some of the passengers are chosen to take a look at another aspect of Hungary's ancestry, that of the famous horsemen, or Cikos, from the grasslands of the great Hungarian plain, or Pusta, at the stud farm and stables of the famed Lipizzana horses. After being shown around the stables, some of the passengers were taken by horse and cart to view the strange landscape of small homesteads, endless grasslands, and huge skies. Motor vehicles are banned from this national park, and this is the only form of transport in which to get around. The Cikos, or cowboys, are descendants of the people who used to inhabit this area, leading a nomadic country life, far removed from the settled routines of the conventional villagers. They were herdsmen and shepherds, and their unique virtuoso horsemanship has been handed down from generation to generation for over 1,000 years, when the great Magyar riders had come thundering in from the what is now Moldavia. Although at first sight it appeared that this show of expertise and whip-cracking was perhaps cruel to the horse as it squatted like an obedient dog, it soon became obvious that this was far from the case, and these horsemen both love and respect these animals. This semi-nomadic way of life, which developed on the Pushta and became one of the emblems of the Hungarian character, have long since gone. But the essence and its ecology are carefully preserved and expertly interpreted for visitors at national parks such as this. One was reminded of the Hungarian poet Sándor Petőfi, famous for his patriotic poem in 1849 during the revolution, "Rise up, Magyar, the country calls." By now, those who had chosen to visit the castle in Eger were now spending some free time in the town itself, sightseeing and shopping. This is the early 19th century neoclassical basilica, or cathedral, and the second largest church in Hungary. Eger is a charming city with endless parades of shops and arcades amongst cobblestone streets, with plenty to do and see. Apart from shops, there are the vibrant street markets, or for those who just wanted to sit and watch the world go by, there are the city squares, lined with pavement cafes. Although we did manage to see most of the city, it did feel as though, with its colourful architecture and busy street life, that there was a whole lot more to explore, and that perhaps in such a short visit, we were missing a great deal of this charming city. However, time was not on our side, and we were taken back on a bus to the train, now waiting at the second of Eger's mainline stations. We were about to embark on the final leg of this adventure, and had only a few more hours to enjoy this fascinating and gracious way of seeing a country. In today's world of fast and efficient air travel between continents, the spirit and the thrill of discovery and adventure has long been overshadowed by the ever-increasing urgency and need for speed. The final destination being the modern-day traveller's main concern, rather than the excitement of the journey and seeing the countries unfold along the route. But even in today's modern high-tech world, it has still been possible to enjoy what has to be one of the most gentle and noble means of transport ever invented. And on this journey, where the passengers became real travellers, venturing into countries and towns previously inaccessible behind the Iron Curtain, and in a style that would only have been granted to heads of state or visiting communist dignitaries. As we now run full steam towards Budapest, hooting, rattling and swaying through the rolling hills and farmland of northern Hungary, it's time to sit back and ponder on what we have experienced over the past 3 days. An adventure into the past through three countries, the Czech and Slovak Republics and Hungary. Three countries connected by iron rails that were once joined by the iron fist of communism and hidden from the world by the grey shroud of the Iron Curtain. The Imperial Express had given us an opportunity to see Eastern Europe without relinquishing the style and comfort of the West, and to take a brief glimpse at how communism was a very good thing for a select few. Now approaching Budapest's Nyugati station, we leave the scene where we came in, as this magnificent train glides onto the station concourse to a fanfare of steam, whistles, and the waiting crowd that's gathered to witness the arrival of the world's most secret train, the Imperial Express.